Thank you, Ian. Thank you for having me and for, I think, all three generations of my family. They've been up busily helping themselves to the buffet at the back. Look, this is an indulgent kind of session for me because I'm asking a question which I've been asking myself for a long time, and by the end of it, I hope that I've come to an answer at least. It's a very, I don't think you can overestimate the mission that this guy has taken on. Taking on, going to war on the idea of corruption in China is brave on many fronts, and I want to take you through a few case studies, and so you can start to see some patterns, as I came across them myself. And then at the end of it, you can sort of ask yourself, okay, is this achievable? Who are the enemies? And if you defeat the enemies, then what next? So there's no question. This is, the rise of Xi Jinping has been a game changer in every sense. After at least 20 years, and particularly the previous decade of divided rule, in the sense that the Communist Party is a system designed for one dictator. It was designed by Lenin, Stalin, Mao, these sort of characters who were not known for power sharing agreements. But China for 20 years, since Tiananmen, since the death of Deng in particular, has been divided in the sense it hasn't had a single leader that can pull it all together and get everybody to sing the same song. And in those conditions, it was, and I think when I was in China for the 6 years I was in China till 2013, we were watching, the gradual fragmentation of this great centralized edifice. And under Xi Jinping, all those processes have been reversed. When I arrived in China, my views weren't that different to the views of the business people who come out every now and again, like all of these characters, and tell you that China is, on the face of it, a very successful place. It was a shiny, efficient, well-oiled machine, and it was known as a meritocracy. People were talking about a China model as a genuine counter model to what we've got in democracies like our own. And I kind of arrived in China with a lot of those sorts of assumptions, as people like Jeff Raby and Andrew Forrest in that picture would want to tell me. I should point out the guy on the far left, this is in Zhongnanhai, this is in one of the pavilions in Zhongnanhai, and the guy on the left didn't hand out his business card, but he's the Lieutenant General in charge of one of the PLA's intelligence departments. And one of the interesting things is just every year, this guy is Xing Yunning would arrange Andrew Forrest and Jeff Raby and his mates to come to the Boao Forum, and they'd all have their little festival and go out and talk about China afterwards. But this year was interrupted because the Lieutenant General was arrested for corruption just before the Boao Forum. My time in China was really a journey of discovery, almost every single day. And every time I left Beijing in particular, it would be another layer of the onion sort of just flying off, and that's how it works. And each time it was like, oh, no, that's how it works. But one of the big moments of discovery was meeting this fellow. In fact, I didn't meet him because just before I got there, this is right up on the Russian border up in Heilongjiang, right on the edge of Siberia. His name is Yu Changwu. And he invited me up there because he had, just announced that he had redistributed land. In fact, he'd privatized land in his little village, and that was news because I didn't think you're allowed to do that under the Chinese constitution. But we flew there, got in a taxi, train, taxi, got to this place, and of course, as often was the case, the day before I got there, this guy had been arrested. But in the meantime, we assembled in, it's just a small village, maybe 300 or 400 households, and everybody wanted to talk to this, me and my assistant, a guy called Liu Shuangxi. Everybody wanted to talk to us and tell us the story. And, I was actually quite shocked because the story they were telling me is this wasn't just a land dispute that I'd walked in on. This had been a land dispute that of epic proportions that had been building for about 15 years. And in the mid-90s sometime, and this is all happening in about half an hour, people just telling me their stories. In the mid-90s, a South Korean company, which I actually don't think ever existed, arranged to buy half the village land in joint venture with the township company, with the township government's company. And they did that in this village, which meant that half the village land, so every household in the village were required to give away half of their land to the joint venture project. Now, it was a very kind of nebulous kind of joint venture project. In fact, we never saw the South Korean company, and nor did we ever see the project. But what happened in this village, and all the villages one by one in the township, about 16 villages, and something like 40,000 acres were involved, which in Chinese land terms is not small. The same thing happened where between a third and a half of all village land was transferred to this imaginary joint venture project. And over a process of years, the ownership of this land was transferred from the company to the children of the office holders in the township government, but there was no business that was ever actually done. And so what would happen is then they would rent the farmers back their own land. And so over this huge tract of northeastern China, we had replicated the feudal system that the Chinese Communist Party had thrown out in 1949, if it had ever existed at all. And so this was a big kind of moment of awakening for me. So, oh gosh, nobody told me about this. It had never actually been reported anywhere. Was it happening elsewhere in China? I don't know. Why don't you guys go and sort of scream about it? Why don't you go and tell Beijing what's happening? And just as they were about to answer my question, six police cars came and took me away. I never got the answer. So I went back a year later trying to see this, and I did. He was let out eventually. And this time I was much more sensible about how I got there. I went in a taxi in the middle of the night and arranged to meet in a safe house. Got his story. And, he passed me things like x-rays of his friends with bullet wounds in their heads. And I realised this is not just a land dispute. It had become a virtual sort of civil war environment. And whenever they'd gone to petition to the next layer of government, they'd been intercepted, arrested, etc. But for the government to enable to maintain this sort of this almost Trumanville facade about what's happening requires ever exponentially increasing resources of coercion and propaganda. So you have to stop an increasing number of people from petitioning to the next level of government, which means you intercept them, have to lock them up, intimidate them. They ended up subcontracting a lot of the violence to literally triad groups from southern China. That's where that's where the bullets came in. And then they had to, by the time, by 2012, 2013, they were paying enormous sums of money to the relevant departments in Beijing to make sure that that this never became a public issue. And so now we have this ecosystem which is stretching across, not just a little pocket of, on the edge of Siberia, but all the way to Beijing to the central organs. So that was a little journey of discovery for me. Was that a one-off? I couldn't be sure when I was there. But time after time, I came across cases where it was the marriage of money and political power and coercion, the security apparatus. Very similar stories. This is slightly more complicated because Stern Hu did take bribes, although even that I'm not so as sure as I used to be with some information that's coming out of jail at the moment. But interesting that the guy that testified in court through a recording paid $9 million in bribes to another Rio Tinto guy, he's doing fine. He's a multi-billionaire diversifying into private equity and golf courses. This is the guy on the right, Du Shuanghua, whereas Stern Hu is still in jail. But time after time, it's not just a Chinese thing on the edge of Siberia. Australian business people were experiencing the same thing. You build a business like Matthew Ng, in this case it was a travel business, a very successful one. You get to a critical point where it's very profitable, and then you obey the unwritten rules, you know, and they're always changing, but it's effectively you redistribute, you know, a large share, if not the large, if not the majority share of your winnings upwards to the patronage, to whoever is the sort of the powerful bureaucrat in your fiefdom. Matthew Ng didn't play that by those rules. He spent 5 years in jail. He's just come down back home on a prisoner swap agreement in the Hunter Valley. So serving out his time for a crime he never committed, for building a successful travel business. A very tragic story, actually. It gets worse if you think about the effect that it has on the families. And then I came to realise actually it's not just entrepreneurs at the low level, at the city level. This model of dealing extends right into the Politburo. And so this is, you know, what I was discovering down in Chongqing in 2009, 2010, that Bo Xilai, who was the great mafia slayer of Chinese politics, who actually made his name by first acknowledging that there was a mafia problem in China, and then go to these great theatrical ends to solve the problem. But it became pretty clear, you know, after talking to a few people in Chongqing, that, you know, really what he had done is he replaced the old systems with his own. And personally, I don't think Bo Xilai was particularly interested in money, because he was an heir of the, he was one of the owners of the nation, so to speak. You know, his father had helped to build the country. He was playing on a much bigger field than just Swiss bank accounts or chalets in the south of France, although his wife had some of those. But his currency was all about, you needed to maintain these systems of coercion and pet entrepreneurs to translate the money back into political capital. If he was going to make it to the top, he had to have this very, very, very extensive and sophisticated financial machine, which involved all sorts of people having their own patronage arrangements and extending above him as well, and he was already in the Politburo. And I think that quote is from his father, that as one of the sons was related at the funeral, and I think it's very apt. Excuse the fuzzy photos. That brings us to the new guy. So this is Xi Jinping. So he's on the top, your top left. The old man, the great man, the patriarch of the Xi family, is Xi Zhongshun in the red cardigan in the front middle there, sitting down. Qi Xin is to your left sitting down as well, the matriarch. And I mean, it's a very interesting family in all sorts of respects, not just because Xi's father was, you know, one of the great revolutionaries, not in the inner core, but perhaps he makes the top 100, which is not a small thing in a country of 1.25 billion people. But you look at that family, and his father stands for something in Chinese politics. You know, it's not really ever written down. But his father stands for being on the right side, being with the people. Fought lots of battles going right back to the 1930s, where you could say, you know, if it was a contest between coercion and reform, or pluralism and dictatorship, he tended to be on the pluralistic reform side of those contests. Certainly, in the early days in the 30s, and certainly in the reformist 80s, and so all the close allies of Xi's father were on that reformist side of politics. But by the time you get to 2000, or in the last few years to 2007, when Xi Jinping was elevated. Was anointed as the next president of China, and certainly by the time you get to the 18th Party Congress in 2012, it's a very complicated picture. So Xi's father's side of politics had suffered very badly, you know, since the 80s, particularly after 1989. The reformists, who had in many ways been running China, were no longer. And so a different bunch of people were running China after 1989. And their model of doing things, you know, after 89, you no longer, it was a very different narrative. It wasn't, you know, the 80s were a very optimistic time. And after 89, you needed something different, something a little bit more cynical, something stronger. You know, the patriotic education campaign became much more important. Ideology became important on a surface level. But I think it's fair to say that almost nobody believed it anymore, because there's actually money that started to make the system work. And these elaborate financial patronage systems that I've been talking about really built after 1989. And that whole period is the period in which Xi Jinping was being promoted up the ranks. And so he was effectively made by this money patronage system, even though his father's from, you know, a different lineage, and all his father's allied families had a lot of faith in him. And I made it my business to try and get to know as many of these people as I could. He had earned the trust of the other side of politics, you know, the money patronage side of politics that was known as the Shanghai Gang, to put it crudely, under Jiang Zemin. And they could rightly think that Xi Jinping owed them his job. And when they look around, even in a family photo like this, you know, they could look at Xi's sister, Chao Chao, so second from your left at the back row there. You know, she's a billionaire, and it wasn't just because she's a very, very smart entrepreneur. But so even in Xi's family, you know, there's all sorts of compromises being made. So you would think that on paper, Xi Jinping was not the man that could take on his own system, given that the rot came so close to, you know, right next to his shoulder in this photo. And that's the guy, that's the power broker that, if anyone deserves credit for actually making Xi Jinping the compromise candidate between two very different camps in Chinese politics, crudely simplified as his father's allies and the post-89 power base. It was this guy, Zheng Qinghong. You know, this was Jiang Zemin's, really his guide to Chinese politics. He was the guy that cut deals with all sorts of people and also brokered the deal between the two camps to make Xi Jinping the anointed president of China in 2007 and take the job in 2012. Zheng Qinghong, very important name, has his, you know, it's his network, it's his map that really has charted post-89 politics in China. Another princely. And then he gets to stage and he starts using language like, you know, well, it's a war. You know, we'd heard sort of every 5 years we'd hear a Congress report from Hu Jintao saying that, you know, that corruption is a great threat to the party, and then life would just go on as usual. But under Xi Jinping, it was different. It was different from a pretty early stage, certainly within 6 months of him becoming party secretary. Well, he'd made some very tough comments, but slowly, by about mid-2013, there were some investigations that were making headway, and people started to think maybe this guy is different. By 2014, when he was giving these kinds of comments, and these were only reported in a provincial newspaper and then rapidly deleted afterwards, but I think that they are authentic as far as I can tell. You know, it is a war, and it's seen as a war by his supporters, and, you know, the party is still steeped in its revolutionary language. It's a very martial language, and it's a war against his own party. And it's not something, you know, it's not a straightforward thing. This is not a system which just has institutions, and so I'm the boss, therefore I tell you to do this, and then it happens. This is 25 years of institutionalized patronage and money just fused together in every single department that you can think of throughout the Chinese system, and he's asking this same system to declare war on itself. Not a straightforward thing to do. So look, there's all kinds of case studies that I could bring up, but let me just bring out my favourite characters. So Zhou Yongkang. Now, before this guy went down, you know, if any of you had asked me who's the most kind of the meanest, most awful human being in China, I'd say probably this guy, right? And so he was the guy with the guns. He controlled the internal security apparatus, which is, you know, this is not just the AFP in our terms, the Victorian Police. This is in a system where security is the overriding priority, full stop. You know, everything else is a distant second. You know, money might have been second for a while, but security is the priority. This guy had the Domestic Public Security Bureau. This guy had the intelligence bureaus, including overseas and counterintelligence within the country, counterterrorism. But as I'll illustrate this a little bit with a few case studies, security is everywhere. It seeps into every single organ of power in China. Every business deal of any consequence, in some way or another, has to get past the security department. So Zhou Yongkang was not just, you know, the head of the police force. He was head of the most prodigiously resourced and powerful and all-powerful security apparatus that the world has probably ever seen in sophistication and resources. And Zhou Yongkang, who was a protege of Zheng Qinhong, who was the vice president, the guy who gave Xi Jinping his job, had his own proteges all the way down. This guy was the deputy of the Ministry of State Security, the spy agency. He was tipped to be the next boss of the Ministry of State Security. So he's another guy that's gone down only quite recently, actually, and I'll come back to this because Ma Jian was quite a character. And so to give you an idea of the sorts of games that these people play, and perhaps they had to play, perhaps this is not a question of moral judgment and you know, relative venality, but to stay in the system, you have to support these structures of patronage. So one nice visible case study was, this is what's called the Panggu Plaza. Now, if anyone went to the Olympics, Amanda, were you at BHP at the time?
No, I wasn't actually, but I do recall a lot of discussion about this.
And if you think this is a strange looking thing to put right next to the the most important sports stadium in China, right? It is, because it is. And so the Beijing city government refused to approve the development of this plaza. In fact, refused to approve the sale of the land, which in China means they refused to kick off the existing owners of the land and hand it at a basement place price to the relevant business person. And then in 2007, just before the Olympics, the vice mayor of Beijing was arrested. And I didn't know what that was about, I just arrived. But the backstory is only now coming out. And what the vice mayor was silly enough to do was, he's the guy that blocked this approval. And the guy that wanted to make this development was a businessman called Guo Wengui, who's currently somewhere in the United States, busily bashing on his typewriter, saying very mean things about Mr. Xi. But Guo Wengui, the business person, had entertained, the usual thing, entertained all the politicians he could find, and with Ma Jian's help, the minister, the deputy of state security, had managed to get this troublesome vice mayor in very compromising videos and his own salons. And that video of the vice mayor's girlfriends was transmitted straight to the discipline authorities, the top leaders in Zhongnanhai, and so they arrested him. It was a total setup from beginning to end, orchestrated by the deputy head of state security in the Chinese system. And if you kind of think about what that means, the state security is the professional, if there is a professional organization in China, it should be them, because that is, state security is the priority of the Chinese system. And you've got the vice mayor making sex tapes for the benefit of a construction mate of his to build a monstrosity like this. And the top two layers of this monstrosity are all suites handed out to various kind of friends around the place. So that's Ma Jian. This is a story that's just coming out in the last few weeks. And then I was talking to one of Ma Jian's former colleagues, and quite recently, and I said to him, "You must be, did you all know, when you were working in this?" With this guy, did you know that he had six mistresses, six houses, and mates like this? And my mate said, "Well," and this really did surprise me. There was another layer of the onion. My mate said, "That at that level, that's normal. That's what you that's just normal. There was nothing that stood out by his behaviour. In fact, he was the most talented of all the senior leaders we had. And it's a great shame that he's gone. The only reason he's gone is because of his relationship with Zhou Yongkang. Purely political. There's no such thing as a corruption purge, which is not political at that level. And I was a little bit staggered by that, because up until then, I've been telling a story, and I think I'm still going to stick by it a little bit, that every person that Xi Jinping's brought down at a high level is both politically inconvenient and egregiously corrupt. But what I'm starting to, you know, there's a possibility that I've got to sort of qualify the egregious part of that equation. Maybe it is just so rife through the system that it's just taking out politically inconvenient people, even people that weren't egregiously behaved, even when they get up to stuff like this. And so since I've been back in Australia, I tried to write about everything but China, but that didn't work very well. And so this year I've been trying to explain why it matters to Australia, that this is not just an abstract kind of little fishbowl thing going on. And look, I think they're very early in this process, but we've tried to help them along a little bit. And last week, for example, the one case where the treasurer forced the sale of a Point Piper mansion. In some ways, it's quite unfortunate, because the guy who bought it, Xu Jiayin, had done all the right things, and you know, he relied on a dud suburban lawyer. So that was his mistake. But there was nothing hidden about what he was doing. Here I am, I'm using this chain of companies, a locally incorporated company, to buy this so I don't have to get FIRB approval. That turned out to be wrong, you know. But when he was forced to sell it, you know, the people that bought it, the group of people that bought it, is a much more interesting story than he in himself. He was China's eighth richest man in the construction industry, you know. Better not ask, you know, where exactly the first bucket of gold came from, but there he is, he's transparent about who he is now. But the people that bought it are a different story. And in the circle, it's a lady called Lola Wang, who's, you know, if she's got background herself, I haven't discovered it, but in her immediate circle, the most important people around her include the former vice president's son, who we just talked about, this is Zheng Qinhong, the power broker who brought Xi Jinping to power. And then a whole bunch of people who are tied into people like, including Ma Jian, the deputy spy chief. Mm-hmm. And look, I think I'm possibly on, are we on video? Are we, maybe we'll just press pause for a second. but this circle of people that we just sort of accidentally lifted the scab off, you know, to see what was inside. It involves lots of money, it involves lots of nefarious characters, and it involves gambling houses like down the road here as well. Okay, so sort of starting to tie it back together, and I do hope we have more Q&A than me just talking at you. But so this is Xi Jinping's father, Xi Zhongxun. The story that was told outside of China, and also amongst many of Xi's close supporters and family friends in China, was he was from the Cultural Revolution generation. This is Xi's old man. Xi Jinping is 13 years old when his father's being trucked around Xi'an. That was actually when his father had a good, because you could actually see him. So they let the Red Guards loose for a little while and throw things and say mean things about him. But then he disappeared. For 3 years, Xi Jinping did not know if his father was even alive. And he was kept in this, you know, 7 square meter detention cell for a lot of that time. And people kind of, the history of the Cultural Revolution, and in fact the history of Mao's China, has been so airbrushed in important respects, because it's almost like they were different to the Russians. But what Mao did to Xi's father was not different to the Russians, except that Mao didn't use bullets. You know, he would, he brought down roughly the same proportion of Central Committee members as Stalin did, and the impact went all the way down through families, you know. So Xi's mother was beaten up, he was turfed out of home, he spent, you know, weeks, probably months, just kind of drifting between various safe houses in Beijing, half starved, and then sent to the countryside, came back, got arrested, sent back. You know, what they went through, what Xi and others in his generation went through at that age, is, you know, almost inconceivable to people like me who's grown up in a very different world, right? And so how did that affect people? The assumption was, well, we're never going back there. Whatever happens, China has to progress, keep progressing away from that system which almost destroyed our families in the 1960s. But I think what we're seeing now is different to what we expected, because if anything, the lessons that Xi learned from the Cultural Revolution were all learned in retrospect with a bit of distance, but actually Mao was onto something. Because the fundamental question of Chinese historiography is, how do you prevent regime decay? And it's, you know, the whole kind of cyclic theory of history, dynasties are united by great men, invariably, and then they decay over generations. When you get to the third generation, or, you know, it becomes corrupt and it might hold on for another couple of hundred years, but then it collapses and some other great man comes and takes over. So how do you stop the dynastic wheel from turning is a central question of Chinese historiography, and that was what Mao learned from Stalin. The way that you stop your one-party regime from decay is to purge it constantly. So what we're seeing now is not just a one-off kind of campaign, all right, everybody's scared, now we'll all behave and we'll march in the same direction. It's a process of continual purge. Corruption is the weapon, and there's, you know, ideology is the side weapon, which is not to be discounted as well. But I don't think, you know, we're now 2.5 years in, and there's been, I don't think, any relaxation at all. So there's nobody in a senior position in China who feels feels relaxed, as insecure as they've ever been. Huge patronage systems have been just decapitated, and it's going down the system, and presumably they can't go, you know, to all stems of the tree all the time, but nobody really knows which avenue the purge is going to go. But I think purge is, you know, the way that Mao understood that you keep a regime vital. You certainly keep it loyal, but you keep it on its toes. And look, I'm going to throw it open to Q&A, but before I do, this is another one of the Australians who built a great business in Guangzhou. She built a university, an IT university. I've written about her before. Once again, in this wonderful Kafkaesque kind of legal system, they waited until her child was 12 months almost to the day, so that by law you could detain, separate the mother from the child. Then they arrested her while she was breastfeeding. She spent 5 years in a Guangzhou jail, took her university, distributed it to up the tree and to business rivals, and of course the university has almost died now because she's not running it. And then she just got released. She's back in Australia. You know, extraordinary woman. She's managed to kind of, you know, she's just reunited with her now six-year-old son. But another example of you build something, you invest something in something, and it gets taken away and redistributed. But talk to people who have actually been through this, rather than the business people, you know, at the which I showed at the beginning of the program, rather than people that fly in, get Dutchessed, and then flown out again. Talk to people that actually do business, and even people that have made it work for them up until now, 50-60% of their brain space is trying to work the patronage systems and to hedge their bets, and how do I keep this person on side. It used to be you sort of give a little bit of your company to everybody that matters, but they don't know what the rules are anymore, because that is also a very dangerous occupation. And so you are more vulnerable than you ever were, but your insurance policies don't work like they used to before. I will just throw it open. I'm very interested in your questions, but you know, I'm leading to the conclusion that Xi Jinping can win the war. In fact, he's probably already won the war, but I'm really not sure that he can win the peace. There's no sign, and there's not even an articulation of what the new system will look like.
John, thanks very much. That was